probably know someone who's been affected by that. We'll tell you about this opportunity in front of us right now to build one new efficient K-12 building. Right across the street, right where it belongs, in the middle of town, right in the heart of town. The building's flexible, it's modern, where our children can be better prepared for the demands and opportunities of a collaborative work environment that await them. Campus with a new track and field, wrestling room, weight room, restrooms that are actually in the stadium, auditorium for the arts, for plays, for concerts, something that is completely lacking right now. A place where the community can meet and have small group meetings or something big like this. Campus that we can be proud of, the one that reflects the pride we all have in each other and our community. I understand no one wants new taxes unless we really need it. And we need it. We have to take care of the heart of this community. We have to do something about it. Issue 33 is a reasonable plan, okay? Takes advantage of $17 million state funding. It reduces the property tax burden on our retired citizens and our large landowners. And the plan asks those of us working with kids in school to step up and do what's right for our children and for their futures. We've got an opportunity, we have a chance with something on the table right now to vote for a new school on November 7th. Thank you.
October through June of this past year, having all the community members
spend the money when we think it should be spent.
No questions? Come on. Wow.
I've been very active on Facebook answering all kinds of stuff.
Yes, sir.
You were explaining last evening about the tax code. Lower the property value levy. You might have limited that because it's different than anything I have seen or was aware of. And maybe other folks in the room here don't know anything about it either. What benefit would be?
Thank you.
How I do taxes.
And I blew by because I figured someone would ask that question about how much it's going to cost. So this is not just a single traditional property tax levy. And someone mentioned, the conversation came up earlier, that's been declared unconstitutional for years. It really doesn't stop any districts from using it, but we tried a different approach here. Really because, we don't want to put that burden on our retired community and the landowners. So what we're doing is half of the funding, the 30-some million that we fund locally, is going to come from a property tax. So it's traditional 3.95 mil property tax. And then the other half is going to be a more unique and a far less used but equally useful 0.5% income tax. And it's an earned income tax, which means that 0.5% is only due if you have a W-2, if you own a sole proprietorship, or if you have a joint partnership. So retirement income, Social Security, unemployment, capital gains tax, veterans payments, none of that is actually taxed. So the 0.5% falls primarily on working age people. So about half, then 15.6 comes from the bond, 15.8 million will come from the project from that 0.5%. So a question back to you.
Yes, sir.
No, I got order. I'll take an answer.
I know you're building a smaller school than what the three schools are right now. Are we going to be able to live within our operating costs, or are we going to have another operating levy close down the road?
All right, so right now we have three schools, almost 200,000 square feet. The new school was spec'd at, and when I say spec, the state money comes with the state book. Mentioned earlier, there are some stipulations in there. They come with square footage stipulations, and that comes to about 165,000 square feet for the new building. So it's 15% smaller. If you walk around the high school, there's a lot of wide open space in there that really isn't being used for anything at all. So a lot of that space is going to come out of unused areas. The fact that we're into one building, that means one boiler system, HVAC system instead of three. That means one cafeteria instead of car stuff all over the school. It means a lot of potential savings. And you have to build energy efficiently nowadays. The state money comes with the stipulation that you build to LEED Silver status. And LEED is the world-renowned, world-recognized environmental sustainability building code. So LEED Silver means you have to have high R values on your windows. It means you have to have high energy efficient appliances and boilers and things that go in. There are a lot of opportunities to save money on the building operations. And I think we're going to see that. Now, it doesn't mean the healthcare costs for our employees and the school teachers and the administration won't go up, but it doesn't mean that other things won't go up over time. But I think this is certainly a step in the right direction to maintain costs over years. That's my opinion. We don't have financials on it. We don't know what we're building yet, but the evidence is clearly there that we have a more efficient building.
My name's Robert Salves. I've lived here since 1968. My question is, I work construction. I work several different cities. I pay city income tax wherever I'm working. I still have to pay the earned income tax for Bruce Town.
Thank you. So yes, the short answer is yes. This is a school district income tax, right? It's not a city type income tax. There isn't reciprocity with anyone in RETA or at the regional tax authority or anything like that. So my wife and I both work in Akron. We pay 2% there. We will pay an additional 5% on top of that. So if you some school district income tax works, there's a very specific thing for school districts to change their funding source somehow.
Aaron, can you break down for the voters exactly what the different parts of this new construction will cost? For example, the field, the track, you know, the school, the auditorium, you know, just where, I know that the building hasn't been designed yet or whatever, but if you can, if you have some numbers.
Yeah, so there are a bunch of numbers that are put in there. So the big one is the master plan, right? So we talk about total square footage of the school building. You're talking about a $41.4 million school with 165,000 square feet where all of our kids will be in there. The gymnasiums are included in that space. So you, and you can pick what you do. You can have one really big gym or you can have a couple smaller gyms. That's the big master plan. On top of that, locally funded, of course, because the state's paying 41% of that $41 million. There's an additional $7 million that is locally funded. That is budgeted. $2.75 million for the standalone auditorium. And I'm in front of me, of course, I haven't looked at it in a couple days, but you've got $1.9 million budgeted in there for upgrades to the athletic field and the track, $400,000 for the concessions and the restrooms and the locker rooms, $400,000 for the weight room and the wrestling room. And there's some other miscellaneous costs, I believe the board offices have to go in there. They're not funded by the state, even though they might be in the building. It's really kind of strange. And there's some other architecture costs and stuff are in there. So there's a total of $7 million locally funded stuff. It's really the auditorium and athletic upgrades.
Hi, Aaron. My name is Susan. I haven't really followed much of this, so I'm just kind of curious. What is the time frame to build the school? And what are we doing with the students when this is being built? Because apparently the school's going to have to be torn down. So what's the scoop?
Great question. So here's the time frame. Let's say we pass this in November. It takes about 3 months to go ahead and do your bid process. So we have to go out to bid. I believe it's at least three for your architecture company, whoever's going to do the blueprints, and then for your builder. So that's about a 3 month process. And then there's roughly a 9 month build process, and then a 9 month design process, and then a year and a half to actually build the building. So we're looking at 2.5 total years, new buildings opening up August 2020. The in-between is really tough to say, right? Because you know you're going to have to tear something down. We only have 36 acres. You're going to have to tear something down to put something up. We've talked to a number of different schools who've done this recently, and superintendents who have bought trailers, and they're expensive, and then they can't return the trailers to anyone or get any money out of them. And it's a really tough idea, and I think it's the last place that any of us would want to see our kids. I think it's the last place the administration would want to see the kids. So it would be a fairly robust effort with the architects and the builders to work out a very specific plan about what comes down and when and where you put kids in between. There's a lot of space in the high school. Take that lobby, and for a year and a half, could you stand to have the lobby turned into 6 classrooms? Maybe. That's probably a much cheaper and a better alternative than trying to get trailers out there. Don't 100% know. You really don't have an idea until you start into the design phase on it. But again, that's something that the community comes in and is really adamant about. We don't want trailers, but our kids in buildings and safe buildings. And that's something we can build into the process.
Hi, my name is Tammy. My question is, if the school is going to be smaller, with the growth that we're going to have, and we do have, like, I know with Waterloo, a lot of families are talking about bringing their students here, their kids here. So if the school's going to be smaller, then what's going to happen? Because we're going to grow, we're going to need more room.
So my understanding is that when they spec the square footage, they actually look out to at least 5 years out. So I believe they're spec'd out to 2021. For the amount of space, and there is always room to, the square footage allows to have more kids kind of into it. It's not like just enough that you can't fit anymore. These are the I'm looking at my friends up there in the administration. So I know it's something that everyone has to deal with at some point. There's a lot of So there's certainly options there, and that's all part of the design phase. Any other questions?
I have another one.
Great.
First of all, I want to thank you, Aaron, for your I Don't Know You. Our children have long been graduated from Brookstown, but I really want to thank you for your transparency. The website is outstanding. Your questions and answers, and it's really well done. And thank you for putting in all your time, because this is not your job. You're doing this because you love children, so I want to thank you for that. That being said, as a retired educator, is it not when you accept money from the OFC that is also part of that money, that your maintenance is included in that money, that you do not need additional funding to maintain that building?
So the state, if you set up a bond issue like we did, the state required you add an extra additional half mil, which we did. So the real building cost, the bond cost, is 3.45. The extra half is in there already. So that is for, and there are certainly examples of schools who have built new buildings and not been able to afford it right away, needed new money right away. So that's they've started including that. We have that included to help us get underway in the new building. And I still feel, looking at the options that are available to us and the capital structure we have now, that there's really money to be saved, and then that can be used to offset other things.
Hi, Aaron. Couple of questions for you. I am not a fan of the one school system, and you had made mention earlier that there's only going to be one cafeteria. How do you plan on keeping kindergartners away from junior seniors? If one cafeteria, that only means one lunchtime. How do you plan on doing that? Also, you said that there are no official plans in place yet, so you're asking us to pass basically a 4 mil levy plus a 0.5% sales tax with no official plan in place. To me, that kind of sounds like, give me your money, we'll figure it out. Is that kind of what I'm hearing?
So your first question, I probably misspoke. You can share the kitchen and have separate cafeterias. So some of the schools that we saw, Beaver Local down in East Liverpool is one example. The little kids had their own cafeteria, shared the same kitchen, and then the high schoolers had their own separate cafeteria. So it's very easy to keep all the kids in different age groups separated. And if you want them to work together, you want to bring the seniors down to read to the little kids, you can do that in a supervised manner. None of the schools that we've talked to that went with the K through 12 have had any kind of issues with wrong kids being in the wrong place or bullying or anything like that. So from what I've seen, it's a very safe proposition. The second piece is, yeah, there's no design. Quite frankly, architecture company is going to cost at least a couple $100,000, if not more. And I think the community at large would go looking for next in the school board if they spent that much money on something that they might never get to build. We were talking about $59,000 over here earlier. $200,000 plus would be quite egregious. The fact is that the budget dollars, the amount that goes into this from the OFCC, the state book, it's pretty well researched. They've been doing this for 20 years now. They've built well over a couple hundred buildings, they've built tons. I mean, there's new schools everywhere. We're the last one in Portage County right now. There's a lot of really good information that goes into that budget. You can
excited, you know, to go to school and learn these new things, get these new technologies. So what is the benefit of keeping it where it is versus moving it to the new location and getting state funding?
So the only difference with moving to a new site under kind of this current plan, and I'll just say JET aside, is it's going to cost us $4.8 million extra to estimate it. Okay? The same building gets built on either site with the same technology capabilities, the same open concepts, flexibility, everything we're talking about. It doesn't matter where you build it. If you build it across the street or if you build it in a farm field somewhere, you're going to get the same great new building. You will have the same quality of athletic facilities. The only difference is if we stay here, we don't have to redo the stands, we don't have to regrade the ground, we save, you know, $2-3 million there. And we don't have to run sewer, we don't have to run electrical, it's all here. It's really just prepping the land and building new athletic facilities. You gotta pay for that if you move. Otherwise, we're getting the same building. There's no compromises being made by staying on this lot. It all can fit.
I agree with your comment about, you mentioned that you want to be there when the design of this building is going to take place. I assure you, I will be there as well, because I am just appalled at the look of the new Streetsboro High School, because every time I drive past that school, I see razor wire, I see guard towers, I see a pseudo-penitentiary. To me, when we talk about the educational environment and how enlightens our children, and it's better. When I drive past it, I said, I am sure glad as hell that I don't have to go to school there. And I can't imagine what it's going to look like in 50 years.
I certainly appreciate that. And I'll tell you what, one of the things that's come up a number of times is, you know, people love the old school. People love that 100-year-old building. It's very classic. There's a lot of really cool features in it. I think there needs to be a good contingent from the community that comes in and says, what can we bring from the old buildings forward? What pieces can we bring? What architecture? What anything that kind of reminds us of what the small town is supposed to look like. I don't like the way Streetsboro looks. I think we do a hell of a lot better.
I think we have time for about 2 minutes, two questions, I'm sorry, because we said we'd close this up by 8:30, so I think Ralph, you've got one there. Is there any others?
Sites. I understand that there's additional cost, but from what I have seen of the numbers, it sounds like it's a less than 10% addition, yet it would potentially bring water, sewer, blah, 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 out to whole new areas of the township that could take advantage of it. It would also free up 36 acres of probably the most expensive land in the township that could be developed for business that would help to support those schools for the next 50, 60 years. And I'm wondering if that was considered at all as part of the equation.
Okay, so I'll start by reminding everyone that I am not on the school board, I am not in the administration or anything. This is just me learning, talking to everyone over the course of the last many months. So as far as the utilities down, and let's just be transparent, the only lot in town that was potentially for sale, I think it's since been sold to the farmer who was using it. And would fit the lot, and it didn't have any bad over, you know, didn't have power lines or railroads or anything, was the lot on the corner of New Milford and Cook Road. It's an 80-acre lot, it's right next to Gracie Field, it's directly east of Gracie Field. So the utility costs would only run power just an additional, like, down to the corner. And there were a couple of houses in between where it was and where it was going. The sewer wasn't actually passing any more houses. It stopped at the last house up the road. So the additional utilities would only serve the school, unless someone could build an allotment across the street or something like that, a new subdivision or something. As far as the land, the economic development, you make a great point. But the fact is, with only one lot available and the unknowns about whether they can purchase it or not, and the additional millage that would be required to move, the school board, this is my understanding, board just thought there are too many uncertainties. Now, quite frankly, having surveyed people and talked to people in the course of the last several months, I think there's a large contingent, like the woman up in the back row here, who would just vote no if you moved it. And I think that could really be underestimated quickly, because that group is going to show up and vote without a doubt. try to move and potentially really end up with nothing. That's my opinion. You know, honestly, I would support the school in either location. I think my first take is that we need a new school out here where it is. But I do like the plan quite a bit, keeping it here, right in the center of town. Yes, last question.
Well, I guess after you say that, this doesn't maybe have as much clout, but I work with, every day I work with overdoses, and I mean death from overdose. I work with people recovering from human trafficking. I work with babies that are withdrawing. And we are in the middle of the corridor from Chicago to New York, this area, including Brimfield. We have a drug issue behind the school, on the side of the school. We are in very close proximity to the expressway. My question is safety-minded. Why would you not move the school on the innermost part of the township when you are, it is a well-known fact that with you, when you are within a half a mile, and we are much closer to an interstate, there is child abduction, there's burglary, there's murder. There's all sorts of things that happen, and the traffic alone is very difficult to get through. We have large trucks going through all the time. Why you wouldn't try to seclude our kids and protect them more in a different location? If was that any part of the discussion?
I believe it absolutely was. The fact is that kids, most of the population of kids in the township, a lot of them are very heavy towards the north end of town. They're driving past the highway. They're driving past 44. They're going that way to get home all the time. The time that they're in the school during the day, whether the building is here or down in a cornfield somewhere a couple miles away, I don't think it matters. The security that you can put in place in a new school building, I was in one in East Texas where I walked in, I got shunted immediately through from the only opening into the office where they ID'd me, I got my time stamp badge, I walked in, and that's the only way in and out, and it didn't matter where the school was. The time the kids spend elsewhere in the community the rest of the day is for the community to really worry about. And those are all valid concerns, very valid concerns. I don't know that there is an appreciable, I don't know if we've had any issues like that during the school day at all. I'm looking behind you, ma'am, the administration. I don't think we've had any so far. I would hope we would not have any more, whether the school is across the street or moved. And I think it's up to all of us. Safe as you possibly can. I don't know a better way to answer that question.